there, people! And welcome to yet another edition of Daggerfall! We have been marathoning this stuff lately, doing a lot of terrible booking. Why? Because I want to be done with this godforsaken book series! I hate it so much just sitting here reading book after book after book. It's boring to pretty much everyone involved, I think. Yeah, I don't think anyone here really would ever care about reading all the books. I am not exactly thrilled about reading all the books, and I don't think anyone else is. But at the same time, it's a goal I kind of started, and I'm the type of person who likes to push forward and beat these random goals I set for myself for some reason. So yeah, completionism. We must do it. I'm not going for full completionism, by the way, people. In order to do that, I think there's something to do with like the quests or so, because of the fact that there are random quests or so. We would have to, like, get, like, all the different random quests we could. And the problem with that idea, I believe, is that this game is more like Morrowind in the aspect that you can't really do all quests in one playthrough. You'd have to, like, do multiple. And, yeah, I'm sorry, but Daggerfall is not the game I want to do that for. I might or might not be doing that for Morrowind if I get that far. But I'm definitely not doing that for Daggerfall. I want to get through this game once, blunder through it, aimlessly do everything we did, and then kind of be done. I don't want to have to redo it and then do stuff for random quests that are basically go to the dungeon, do this, with no real plot line or anything. That's the big difference, I think. If it was like Morrowind, whereby there's like a little bit of plot or something thrown in there, I might. But because there's no storyline whatsoever, I just don't feel encouraged. It just feels completely worthless. So, yeah, I'm going to completely ignore that. And all that. Let's actually get to what we have decided to try and complete, which is the lore box. We have 15 to go, including some lengthy books that are multi-parts. But we do have found a library. That may help me. Uh-oh. Oh boy, I thought I saved as end of last stream. But I'm not seeing end of last stream. Let me throw that up for you guys. I'm gonna go looking for my last video. I wanna see exactly how I ended it. See, this is why it's useful, because now I can look and see what exactly I did. Because, I don't know, but half the time it seems like I'm not saving properly. I tell you, I must like get so impatient with like reading. I must just, like, shut it off and be like, I'm done! And, yeah, I kind of forget to save the game in the right slot. Where was I? Okay, I saved too many generic names. Okay, so too many generic names is the right one. That was right before I shut it off. Okay! As you see, that was convenient, quick to load up, and this is exactly why we record all this stuff. and this is why it's awesome for my benefit. Let's load it up. Now we have a massive freaking list of stuff we've read. I've updated it all, now we have only 15 books. I could completely care less about that. Hooray! We have the same few freaking books we saw last time! I believe I've read all these except King Edward, of course, which... That's because that's going to be like a 12-parter series. And we kind of need 3 more parts. Yeah! This is going to be a pain in the butt. Let me pull up my Daggerfall list so that way I have some idea what I'm reading. Let's see here. I can actually like look at it right here and look at all of them. Okay, so we have Tale of Kirin, I've read. Ancient Rulers, I've read. Eos Animal God, I've read. The Sage, I've read. Did I say Eos? There's 2 copies of Eos Animal God. Really? 2 of the same freaking book in the same book rack. Well, that's brilliant. And they're completely unorganized, so basically, like, be like, looking at just a random list. Okay, Confessions of a Thief, we've read. Mysticism, we've read. That's Unfathomable Voyage. Invocation of Azura, we've read. So yeah, we're doing good, we're reading lots of books. I don't know how this is accomplishing anything, but it's books. Is there like an easier way to X out of this? I'd like an easier way to get out of this. Seems like I have to like just deal with that menu. Okay! Wait a minute, what? There isn't! People, there wasn't 7 parts to the Barinza story before. And I actually think that was a biography of Barinza, wasn't it? Let me see this for a second. That doesn't sound right. This might actually be another series, people. Yep, that was the biography of Queen Barinza. Oh dear god. We have just learned that there is actually another freaking book series. That apparently is at least 7 parts. Yeah. Actually, there's part 6 and part 7 right here. Yeah, I gotta like keep track of all this stuff. There's way too much. Okay, we also have a Vampires of the Iliac Bay. I need to see what part it is, though. That would be useful. I'm gonna have to like click on it just to see what part it is, ain't I? Let's see, I'm gonna have to click on it. Part 1! We found part 1! Finally! Okay, so there's real Barinza. Also, we have like other stuff in here, like the Alakir, I think I've read. Yep, Alakir I've read. Banker's Bet I've read. That's the one with the testicles feather thing. Rude Song, another one that's very rude. 2 Vampires of the Iliac Bay. Interesting, interesting. Beyond that, we have Galerian the Mystic, which we read. And yeah. Let me look at Vampires of the Iliac Bay of both here? Please be both. That's part 1. I don't even know if I'm like clicking the right ones or what. I think it's 2 versions of part 1. Yeah, I think it's 2 parts of part 1. So what we need to do is now find part 2. Like, okay, we have a lot of parts of King Edward here. Like, a lot of parts. Okay, so this is part... In fact, it's all parts that we have. Because I need 3, 6, and 11 I'm looking for. Those are, like, the big ones for me. Part 9 is everywhere here. But yeah. The real Barinza part 2... we're still missing, like... Parts 1 and so. I really don't usually care about a series till I see like a part 1. The Light in the Dark I recognize. But there is the Fairy, which I don't recognize. So hooray, let's get it down to 14. And the Healer's Tale, which I also recognize. So yeah, let's actually get the Fairy out of the way. Since it's a light book. Probably it's actually a lengthy book, is it? Nope, 3 pages. Time to get to 14. Barry had been on Tamriel, and in all probability, long before record history. Perhaps since or before the days of the Elder Ones. The tales of their mischief are found in every culture, and most every village, town, and city-states in the Empire. Alternatively, they are called Fairy, Fae, Illidy, Sprites, Pixies, and Silphim, and the nature seem to flit from one story to the next with the same variation. It could almost be said that fairies are anything unpredictable in nature. The noted scholar Arbathus, studying at the time in the Crystal Tower of Somerset Isle, developed an interesting if controversial theory about fairy. He organized the Fae variants on a chain, begin when the glimmering sparks called Pixies, or Wolokee by the Red Guards, at one end, and the godlike beings such as Gaetus, Cronus, and Zygaria at the other. In the middle are human and semi-human beings, generating up to the intelligent trees, brooks, rocks, even mountains. All this was a new and completely original theory, and would have prompted enthusiastic and somewhat skeptical response had Absardus not added this footnote. It may be that elves as a whole are part of this chain, above Wolokee and below Nephrine. They certainly have similar features and propensities for Magicka as the other fairy. Esbardus, the fairy chain. First hold, second hour, 450 sets. No elf liked to be put in a hierarchy slightly above whimsical pranksters like the Wolocky, and Esbardus was challenged on his assumptions based on the very slight coincidences. Nevertheless, with modification, his fairy chain theory has gained wider and wider acceptance since its publication. The hierarchical chain is not, in the strictest sense, an order of command. While Gaetus and Sigaria are said to be surrounded by a host of minor Siphum, fairies on the whole are not followers nor leaders. Their plans and schemes are not governed by a higher purpose, simply by their own whim. To this, most fairy scholars agree. Because it is based on coincidental evidence and supported by auxiliary theories, it may very well be wrong. So yeah, that was just a light book on fairies. Well, at least we read it. Now we can say, yeah, we can say stuff. We can say that we are now no longer have to read. We have 40 books to read. Okay, let's see here. Is there any books here I don't recognize? Let's see here. The Wild Elves. Scholar's Guide to Nymphs. The Earthshot Woman. The Madness of Pelagius. King Edward Part 3! Yep, that's important. That's important right there. I see that one. Hey, because Vampires of the Iliac May. Hopefully it's Part 2. Fragment on Arcaeum. We've read... The Story of Lycerus. I don't think we've read that one. No, we haven't read that one. Okay, so that's another one. But I want to read this vampire one just in case it's part two. Because if it is, we'll be happy. Because that means part one and part two right here, right now. Part one. Ah! Why is it we cannot find part one and part two in the same area? Anyway. The Story of Lycerus is right here. So let's read this. While we're here. Since it is another three-story page, it will get us a 13 books! 13 freaking books! Every one of these helps! In ancient times, there lived a hero named Lycerus. He fought against the Alakaviri slave traders and single-handedly slew hundreds. Despite his valor, Lycerus' army was routed and scattered to the four winds. Lycerus fled into the moors to escape the Akaviri chariots. Far from the lands of men, Lycerus entered the blasted lands. At the height of this forsaken landscape, he met the worm. The great scaly beast mocked the mighty blows of Lycerus' enchanted spear, and melted the shield, fear-struck, gift of the danger of Boenta, with a single blast of its fiery breath. Lycerus, seeing that he could not defeat the creature by force of arms, surrendered. The worm intended to devour Lycerus when the hero offered to be its slave and manservant. Ever prideful, the worm agreed. Seeing that the worm was vulnerable to conceit, Lycerus spoke. Oh, great worm, for my first service, I beg that you allow me to polish your one tarnished scale. Indeed, centered between the great wings of the creature was a dull scale, clearly out of reach on its long neck. Its vanity was such that I immediately lowered one wing for Lycerus to climb. Once astride the great lizard, Lycerus slid his dagger underneath the scale into the tender flesh of the beast. Though its spine twisted in all directions, the worm could not get at the hero. Finally, it took to the air. Lycerus clung to the back with all his strength as the worm banked, rolled, and dove. Seeing that Lycerus could not be shaken free, the worm demanded that he remove the stinging blade. Lycerus answered, "Fly straight on till you see a great army. Destroy that army, and I will remove my blade." With a great roar, the scaled creature set off. The Akaviri army had no chance against the fire-breathing beast. They had never plagued Tamriel since. "I've done as you bid. Now sheath your stinger," roared the worm. Knowing that he would be devoured or worse, Lycerus pulled the blade, and then leapt from the back of the flying worm. Indeed, the foul monster had intended to slay the hero. The worm pursued the plumbing Lyceris. Blainta appeared beside the fallen hero. Praising him for ultimately destroying the army of Alcabia, she turned him into a raven. Lyceris quickly lost the worm in the clouds. Legend has it that the worm still lives, though this happened in the first era long, long ago. The dragon nurses a grudge against Lyceris and all of his kind. He has vowed never again to trust two-legged bearers of weapons. Scholar's note. If this legend has a basis in fact, the artifact Fearstruck was utterly destroyed. No other reference to it has ever been found. And yeah, it also teaches us a very important moral. Specifically, if you cannot beat somebody, sneak under them where they're weak and destroy them that way. Take the cowardly route out, people. That's the lesson of the day. Okie dokie, lots of King Edward parts here. Let's see here, any of them that are good? Lots of real Barinza too, and lots of other stuff here. Yeah, boy. Let's see here, first of all, for King Edward, we have... That's part 8. VII. Would that be 7? So that's 8 and 7, so we already have all those. Yeah, so these are all parts that we have. We have Barinza. We still have yet to see part 1. But it's nice that we see a bunch of different parts, because that means we'll start, like, counting them all up when we see part 1. Of Jafia we've seen, but Olander's hammer I do not recognize at all. So guess what that means? To 12 parts we go! That's what that means. Soon it'll just be all the part-based ones, isn't it? The Instructive Tale for Children! 6 pages. Okay, let's do this. Let's learn about hammers. The two children, Frodrig and his younger sister, Sylvanda, had been exploring all morning. The noon sun was directly overhead, and everything was warm and bright. They had left their Redguard village, Grenista, early that morning for a day in the wilderness, a picnic, and with a stern warning from their father to be home before dark. They crossed a huge field that was bare, save a single rose bush right in the middle. The little girl asked Frederick about it. Well, he said, according to father, a great battle was fought in this place many years ago. The battle was visited by the god of all warriors, Raymond Evanarm, who caused the leaders to end the battle and return to their homes. It said that the rose bush grows where he stood that day. Actually, I remember that story. Oh, how exciting, giggled Sylvanda. The children continued their trek, approaching some woods. As they entered the forest, the air became very cool, and a deep quiet seemed to envelop them. What is that? Sylvanda pointed to a large hole in the ground from which protruded a long, thick pole. Around the hole, thorny plants had grown into an impenetrable wall. I don't know, said Frederick. Let's see if we can get a closer look. Stop! They did. Looking beyond the hole, the children saw an elderly Redguard of many years. His gray beard, scraggly hair, and stooped shoulders certainly did not support the authority and command he gave. But the children stopped just the same as he approached. Who are you? Stammered Frederick as Sylvanda carefully tucked herself behind her brother's back. My name is Henwing Grovinger, and I live in these woods. Why can't we examine yon hole, Master Grovinger? Asked Frederick. Because, my dear children, it and what holds are cursed. Now just who are you? He stuttered, mimicking Frederick. Finally gaining his composure, Frederick said, I am Frederick Ajmer of the village Grenista. This is my sister Sylvanda. We are on an outing. Can you tell us about this mysterious hall? Well, said the old man as he slowly settled to the ground. Well, you sit here with me for a while, and I'll tell you about Olander's hammer. That's the handle of the fabled weapon, stinking out from yonder chasm. With this, the children also sailed into sin positions and fed the old Red Guard Ranger. Grovinger began. Many years ago, there was a huge battle fought in this very field. Oh yes, I know, said Sylvanda, interrupting the old man. It was ended by the warrior god Raymond Ebonarm, and the magic rosebush grows where he stood that day, she continued breathlessly. The old man sternly cleared his throat, causing the little girl to again shrink behind her brother. Now, let me continue without interruption. On the day that battle ended, a young Red Guard soldier stopped in this spot as he was leaving to go to his home. He carried the equipment he had used on the field, which included a marvelously fashioned warhammer that had been given to him by his father. The weapon was beautifully made, and unknown to the young warrior, carried an enchantment that had protected him through the vicious battle just ended. The young man, Olander by name, rested by this very tree. Suddenly he was confronted by a wizard, dressed in all in black from head to toe. Well, so much as how you do, the wizard demanded that Olander give him his hammer. Still fresh in the battle, the young man just looked at the dark man and laughed. The wizard, shaken with rage, raised his hands to cast a horrible spell against the soldier. However, the young man was quicker. The huge warhammer whistled through the air, smiting the wizard a mortal blow, just as the spell left his fingers. There was a loud explosion. The children stared at the old man. He suppressed a grin and continued. Clouds of dust and smoke covered the forest clearing, and when the air settled, yon hole was there with the hammer's handle protruding from it. Olander and the wizard had vanished. The thorny vines you see grew up immediately around the hole, and to this day, no one has been able to approach it close enough to remove that marvelous weapon. Many have tried, and all have failed. It's said that only someone of tremendous merit can take it. All of a sudden, both children in unison stood and shouted, Oh, look how the day has gone. We must go. If we're late getting home, my father will be most unhappy with us. As they turned to leave, Frederick said to the old man, Thank you, Master Grovinger, for telling us of Olander's hammer. You know, I may just come back one day and try to retrieve it. As they disappeared from his view, the old man said to himself, Yes, Master Frodrig, you might just do that. Hooray! Save tree dot dot, whatever that means. That's apparently part of whatever we just read. Yeah. Words! Dot paper! Yeah! Yeah! Words! Yeah! Enfield reading books! Yeah! Okay, that's a way to do it. Empty closet. We need to find a vampire book. Does anyone have any good books on vampires? I have found an attic. A useless attic indeed. I have frozen in midair! Daggerfall! Don't go into the attic, people! It's terrifying! You get stuck up there! Yeah, that was terrible. Okay. I seriously don't even remember which I saved to. I don't think it really matters because I'm reading from a library. I probably just messed up everything. No, I see my... Maybe they stay constant here. I hope they stay constant. Oh my god, there's no books! There's no books, people! There's no books! I'm terrified, there's no books. All the books in that one bookshelf have disappeared. I'm rather confused about that. Let's try this one. Maybe this one will have a functional bookshelf. Hooray! He fits the bookshelf! Maybe it's like ones we've looked at or something. I don't know. I have no bloody clue. Get me out of here. By get me out of here, I mean get me some more books. Because that's obviously what we need right now. We need more books. Books everywhere. Reading books, educating books, books about stuff. Such as these books. These are obviously books that I wanted to read. This is where we kind of started. Now, a lot of this stuff we don't care about. First Scroll of Bandar. Yeah, all this stuff I recognize. Or stuff we don't need. I think that's the same thing we just looked at. Overview of God of Worship. That. So many part ones. No, not Tales of Kieran. Full 70 part the 1th. Full 70 part the 6th? Okay, people. That's it. Time to read about how terrible Full 70 is. You want to read a terrible play? We got a terrible play. All 6 parts of Full 70. Let's do this. Let's get through this book. Let's find part 1. Okay, let's read this thing. Dramatis Personae. Prologue. The adventurer, a dark elf, Rascal Common, a priest of Ashkosh Lieben, another priest of Akosh Epilogue Slate, a priest of Julianos Rake, another priest of Julianos Shub, a maid Shub, a different mage of the same name Nephron, a somewhat sleazy merchant, 5 armorers, Orthokrun, husband of Millie, a lusty Cotisa Millie, innkeeper and philosopher Guernsey, bovine wench, a sword wenches of Cads of the Taverns, soldiers, dwarves, and giants, Daggerfall, and environs of the Doldrums of the Third Era. Part the 1th, concerning priests and knackles, as related at rank by 2 priests of Akatosh to the adventurer, who at the time was not having an adventure, who had nothing better to do, in which some, probably unwanted, light is shed upon the priesthood and its members, upon an old peasant myth of some significance, especially in High Rock, and in which the mysterious Fool's Ebony appears, that strange material that could bring either drastic cultural change for many, or just great profit for a few, or the death of a bunch, or have no result whatsoever. Early in the month of Frostfall, the Dead Daedra Inn. Enter Prologue. Dear God, what have we got ourselves into? Our poor players will try to remember their lines and not trip over a meager set. I beg you, the audience, not to heckle, badger, or throw rotten foodstuffs. You will only make the short play last longer. The Guild of Playwrights, Actors, and Dramatists wish any of you who are sensitive or allergic to rambling dialogue, wooden acting, incomprehensive exposition, or unsatisfying endings that leave one confused and unhappy to exit the theater immediately. Your gold will, alas, not be refunded. As a saving grace, the series of vignettes contains gratuitous references to all pleasures of the flesh. You may enjoy it. Okay then. Ah, here comes our hero. The roguish dark elf called the Adventurer. It's time for Prologue to trip merrily away. Exit Prologue. Enter the Adventurer. What odd conversation I heard between those 2 mages. It's best not to speak of such matters next to privy hedges. Enter 2 priests of Akatosh, Lieben and Coleman. Mind if we join you, fellow? Good. We need some company ourselves. I am named Lieben. My fellow priest here is Coleman. We both serve Akatosh, all in our own ways, of course. Make yourselves at home. It's not my bench. But I thought that priest didn't go to her places like this. Inns, I mean. Unless on duty. Oh, we're not on duty. Got to regenerate our eternal vital energies so we can go on blessing and curing. We have to come here, hike up our robes, kick up our heels, as it were, fill up with some bottled energy! Coleman snickers. Looking for those, they need a comfort and blessing, of course. Oh yes, like that young girl outside the other evening. Lehman kicks Coleman. And anyway, our high priest told us to get lost. He means he told us to get some air. We've been having visions, you see. Yes, sort of weird, really. And we haven't even been talking and taking any of that. Lehman kicks Coleman. Both of us have been having the same visions. Real odd. Do tell. I'm not going anywhere in a hurry. Well, we've been both hearing sort of words for a start. Like Sir Nick or say knock. You said Nick or knock? Just a minute. Let me have a swig from your bottle, brother. Ah, that's better. Quest! Hi, Quest! Stop, you fellows drink! Yes, I recall. Some story of old legend from an elf. Name of Knuckle, I think. From Merwind? You know, maybe you're onto something there. There's an old legend around these parts. Comes from deep in High Rock, I think. Knuckles! That's it! Knuckles, eh? Seems that several dark elves use that name. Particularly the more peculiar ones. Yes, I guess the bad ones are put into all that weapons magicka stuff. Very nasty fellows. To Coleman. Coleman! This fellow's got pointy ears and red eyes. Pardon me, friend. It's sort of dark and I didn't, Oh, it's fine. These are strange times. You know, live and let live. Or die, as the case may be. Now, suppose you tell me about this Knuckles myth. Here, let me help you with this bottle. Ah, thanks. Sure, if you want to put it that way. Here, have another swig. Sure, we've got the time, and I recall it clearly now. Yes, we've got a couple of hours till that little blood shows up by the lamp. Lehman kicks Coleman. Lehman to Coleman. Quiet! Remember, we had to tell the High Priest our address, so she won't be around for a while. Troll. Very well. Here's the story, best as I can recall it. This is a tale the peasants up in High Rock tell their kids to scare them into being good for a while, I guess. They tell it... Let me see. Either on Tales and Tallows, or is it Witches Festival? Just before the kids are sent out to the barn on Pigsty to sleep. Nasty, cruel presents! But then I'd send them out to the midden! Really, Coleman! Remember, those poor souls need our compassion and blessing! We are their salvation! Now who's an old high mucky muck study? Anyway, it goes a bit like this. If the kids have been real good during the year, filched enough in the market, mucked out in the stables every day, not gone playing with goblins, left the sheep alone and so on. If they've been real good, then they've got nothing to worry about. But if they haven't been real good, then there is this nasty, horrid, dark elf spirit named Knuckles. Doesn't look like your typical dark elf. Thinner, taller, pasty white face, long as your arm. Walks like his knees and elbows bend the wrong way. Snickers when you drag your fingernails across slate. Wears a tight black suit. Not Khajiit, more like formal suit with buttons, but not too tight and small. He visits the bad girls and... Why are you talking about old High Mucky again? Lehman? Coleman hiccups. Lehman kicks Coleman. You really must excuse Coleman here. Overwork, you know. To make curings and conversions. Anyway, old nasty Knuckles is supposed to wander under a Tamriel in dirty, deep, dark dwarven tunnels. Everywhere under the lands, if you can believe that. Rides in a rusty, squeaky old minecart on old mine tracks. I saw some of those in Fang Lair once. Oh, nice reference to Arena. down in Hammerfell a long, long while ago. Coleman the Layman, what the sheer grass is he doing in Fang Lair? Oh, Layman, to Coleman, hush! If he's what you think he is, you do not want to know. Child, yes. Well, Knuckles gets pulled all around these deep tunnels by goblins. Not your usual dirty yellow ones, but nasty black things. Anyway, they pull Knuckles round and through these dark tunnels. And then, late at night, he stops below each and every bad child's hovel or house or castle. Makes no difference. Then he slides up the drainage pipes. Creeps up cracks, crawls through holes, oozes up oubliettes. Coins giggling up garderobes. Right into the kids' place! Then, if the kids only been sorta bad, Knuckles would just mess things up in general, so that the kid gets blamed. Make greasy, dirty marks everywhere. More than usual, anyway. Break some things, steal some things, and so forth. Maybe take the sugar sweets. Leave some lumps of fool's ebony instead. Fool's ebony? What's that? Heard mention of that, oh, a few years ago. Some mages, you did now. Interesting. Very well. Let's talk of that in a bit. Let me just finish this Knuckles thing. Where was I? Oh yes. Now, if the little brat has been real bad, then all the little brat's toys get taken. The copper dagger, the wooden sword, the little whip, and so on. All the usual favorite kid things. Whips? I like those! Coleman hiccups. Leben kicks Coleman. Now if the little brat has been very, very bad, then Knuckles grabs the brat, pops him in his or her dirty great sack, hauls the sack down the holes and cracks, down to his rusty old minecart, and away they go! Hopefully he leaves some bad little girls behind! Leben kicks Coleman. So, we can save them, of course, friend. Well, sometimes. So I've heard tell, the brat never comes back. No great loss, I guess. Peasants just breed another. No battle that I do. We even pinches Coleman's nose. But, as the story goes round here anyway, often that brat is just put to work, digging out lumps of fool's ebony, shoveling dirt, bagging it, extending the tunnels of the Knuckles. After a while, Brat is pushed up to where it came from. Seems that Brat might think it spent a year down there, but only a day has passed up top. Brat comes back real thin and dirty though, covered in black mess. You know, come to think of it, on the day past Witch's Festival, I've often seen some little brats, scrawny, real dirty black mess on them, looking terrified too! Parents drag them into temples to get blessed and cured if they have the gold. By the beard of Sheergrath, the wailing and noise! Enough to drive a priest to a... Yeah, well, never mind. That's our problem. No, it's a problem with our suppliers, I tell you! We even throws Coleman through a screen. Anyway, that's the short of it, this Knuckles legend up around here. I recall now, it's widespread all over Tamriel, and nowhere in the place, much more than a grain of truth in the tale. Much, much more. So I guess some of the, dark elves sort of identify with this Knuckles, take on the persona, so to say. Yeah! That sort of sums it up, I guess. Though we don't see any of those types hauling off brats and sacks, do we? No, that's what we does. Girly brats anyway, isn't it not? Coleman hiccups. Leben breaks a bottle over Coleman's head. Coleman falls unconscious. That's a very interesting tale, gentlemen. Say, let me repay you with another bottle. What's that you're drinking? Ah, thought so. Innkeep. More holy wine for these holy men. A blessing on you for that kind gesture, friend. I thank you. I sure could use one or three. Anyway, this fool's ebony. I've heard mutters and murmurs about that of late, mostly eavesdropping. Pardon me, listening to mages and the like. What's with this stuff? Here, have another swig. Good. Well, we're not supposed to tell outsiders. But then, you seem to know something already. If you have been hearing mage gossip, why, maybe we could do some business. Profit all round. Well, for the Akatosh Chantry, of course, and for your fee, good sir. More and more interesting. Tell on, I pray you. Coleman staggers to feet. Coleman hiccups. Time for me to go convert that little lamppost girl! No! Not last night's one, but the blonde! Exit Coleman. Female squeals from offstage. Friend, you have to excuse Coleman. He's a bit, you know, strange. Got these. Oh, that's alright. We've all got our own. It's Aunt Lieben and the Adventurer. Enter Epilogue. Our apologies for the quality of this drama so far. If those of you still present will wait a few minutes while our bard plays Silence Implies Consent, we'll change the set for the next act. Part the tooth. Please don't forget to tip your wench. Do you believe there's such a thing as Fool's Ebony? Maybe we'll find out in Part the Tooth. Or maybe not. Flourish. Exit Epilogue. End of Part the Oneth. Being mostly concerned with the Legend of Knackles. And yeah, now we're basically up to date with where we left off with that terrible one that Damis and Netsus were here for very early on. Long, long ago. Let's read it! To catch everyone up and also to figure out what exactly is going on. Dramatis Personae. Prologue the Adventurer. A high elf rascal Coleman, a priest of Akatosh Lieben, another priest of Akatosh Epilogue Slate, a priest of Julianos Rake, another priest of Julianos Shub, a mage Shub, a different mage of the same name Nephron, a somewhat sleazy merchant, five armorers, Ortho Kroon, husband of Millie, a lusty Quintess of Millie, innkeep and philosopher of Guernsey, bovine wench, a sword wenches, and cads of the taverns. Part the tooth. Bearing mostly on fool's ebony and temples. Same place, same inn. A bottle or two later. Enter Prologue, the Adventurer, and Lieben. Little has happened so far in our comedic drama. The Adventurer, a dark elf rascal, has bought drinks for two priests of Akatosh. All have drunk considerably. One of the priests has rushed off in pursuit of his lamp girl. Unless I've forgotten something, or something else happened while I was paying attention to something else, that's a complete synopsis of Part the Oneth. Ah, here come two more priests. Humble Prologue must depart. Enter Rake and Steet.
Evening, Raven! Evening, stranger! My fellow priest here is Steet. I am Rake! We are honored to serve Julianos!
What is this anyway? Priest night out? I thought that your temples, Akatosh, Julianos, the rest, I thought them all cutthroat competitors, ideology and gold, if you'll forgive my bluntness, yet you all seem the best of friends. Come to think of it, I didn't have any words with Steed earlier. You said you were from the Temple of Stendar?
A common misconception, friend!
But one that
we encourage.
Really? We work together closely. More between the temples as needs dictate.
Exchange information, share funds, swap our sisters. We even kick-steeped. Enter Prologue.
Sorry to interrupt the merry slapstick, but I neglected to mention earlier that the Fool's Gold Saga, if that is the word, contains gratuitous references to priestly misdeeds and sexual excess. I hope that those of you in the audience are peevish, prudish, sullen, frumpy, or grumpy demeanors are not offended. Now then, on with the entertainment!
Exit Prologue.
And all that! but it helps in our holy work if we are perceived as separate and, competitive. Mind you, there are one or two, religious organizations, well, sort of, that we do not have anything to do with. Nothing at all, nothing at all. Animals, just as animals, such as... Well, the Dark Brotherhood, for one nasty bunch of thugs, and then there's the After Dark Society, aside to Rake. This fellow seems a decent sort of chap, seems to know something about mages and fool's ebony. Rake aside to Lehman. Really now? How interesting. Tyrell. Hey fellow, have another bottle. This will bless your throat. My, my, indeed it will. Thanks, Rake. Don't mind a bit. But let me continue. I was explaining about this fool's ebony to you. Yes, fool's ebony. Well, fool's ebony now. Well, you know about ordinary ebony, how it's rare. Only some dwarven clans dig it and sell it. And not too many, these times and days. How's that popular song go? Thinking. Where have all the dwarves gone long time ago? Leven throws Innkeep at Steet. Rake breaks chair on Innkeep and Steet. Innkeep loses consciousness. There's a pile of real ebony up in the Rothgarian somewhere north. I hear tell. You know how that dullish black ebony gets worked over by mages? By some skilled armorers, made into all kinds of potent weapons, amulets, belts, what have you. I'll fetch a huge price when you can find any. And how the best was made long ago by those old dwarves. Steep rises to his feet. We even kick Steep back down. The adventurer something in his tunic. Oh my! Oh my apologies, friend, sir! I see you have... What's that? An ebony torque? Oh my! An ebony katana! Oh my! Oh my my! So of course, you know all that, sir. Oh, that's alright. You didn't know. Here, have another bottle. Many thanks, kind sir! Well then, you know how every adventurer, even snotty kids, all the dungeon delvers, are always looking for ebony artifacts, weapons, whatnot. Especially me with my ebony bloody daikatana! But what you may not know, some of the more experienced delvers hunt for raw ebony loads, piles, dwarven lebens. That stuff, the raw ebony, is far more valuable. The raw and cheap material that provides work and power for so few, apparently just loaded with negative magicka? Right, right! Yes, right so! Quite so! Well, fool's ebony now looks just about like the real raw stuff. Runs in veins in the deep rocks. Feels the same, smells the same. But the big difference, it's not real ebony. No power at all. If you pick some up, it gets your hands a bit dirty. Softer too, by all accounts, but sort of shiny too. But who can tell all that, deep in some old mine? Maybe a ghoul breathing down your neck? So it's just grab and run, I guess, down in these nasty holes. So the fools, the kids, the crazy delvers, are always hauling up a bag, a sack, a fool's ebony, and getting laughed at by the merchants, dealers, mages, us! Hence the fool's part! Stuff just gets thrown into the bay! Yeah, that's sort what I, heard from the mages. But I heard something else, too. And just what was that, friend? If you want to tell us, of course, sir. Oh, of course. I think we can come to an arrangement. We've been raked together. Certainly! So, yeah. So these mages, Shub and Shub. They're always called Shub, aren't they? Anyway, these old guys were saying how this fool's ebony can burn. Not magically. Or like an ordinary piece of wood. But the flame lasts longer, gives off lots more heat, makes no smoke to speak of, no noise. Very interesting. Mages are saying how the Alchemists want it, to heat the retorts and flasks. How the Mages Guild wants it, to make and sell her fake amulets and the like. Rotten trick that. And especially the Armorers. They want it bad for their forges, I guess. And the Alchemists for their Limbecks. So basically everyone's trying to rip us off. So Ripke was probably getting ripped off in there, but yeah. Precisely my information. Now, gets cold up here in the winter, doesn't it? And everyone is cutting down all these trees, making siege engines, boats, all that evil war machinery, all those rich royals and peasants and merchants got to eat their great piles of homes. So their contestants can run around in nets to nothing instead of furs. Just like my sister. Leaven bites Steve's arm. Steve shrieks and falls unconscious. All those armorers got to keep their hearts and furnaces running. All those mages got to keep their familiars warm. All those royals got to keep their contestants running. All those peasants got to keep their animals warm. And the sheer got to the wife and kids, right? Ha! And I guess it's sort of hard for your priests to get blessings and cures when your fingers are all cold and stiff. Makes getting corks out a tad hard, to say nothing of those little twists of parchment. You speak truly indeed! A man of wisdom, yes! So, where do we find this fool's ebony and quantity? You put your finger! You have sense, I note. Oh, excuse me, sir. I'm the crux of the matter. I've heard rumors, just rumors, mind you, that there are huge, enormous veins of stuff at one place on the surface, far up in the Rothgarians. Bad, bad place to go. But if you can get there and back, cartloads of the stuff. That's just what I heard from the mages, far up in the Rothgarians. Orcs, dragonlings, Daedra, Sheergoth only knows what. Those mages seem to know the spot though. Mages wanted someone to. You didn't talk to the mages. I mean, you haven't. Oh no. They didn't even know I was there. Aside, not yet anyway. Good, good. Can't trust those mages. No old fossils would turn their own mothers into sledge toads just for a bit of gold. Gold mad, power mad, mad mad, the whole lot and lot of them. But then they don't have mothers. Excellent. Seems to me, friend. Or can we call you partner? Yes, excellent. Seems to me, partner, that my brother priest and you should do some digging and poking around. See if we can get to those veins. Those deposits, eh? Yes, indeed, partners. But it would cost a fair pile of gold to get up there. Weapons, spells, women, clothing, carts, and horses. Women, food, potions. Best go well prepared up there. No problem, partner. Our temples have certain resources. Such as if we were guaranteed sole access, sole knowledge of the location, then we could finance someone with the requisite skills, such as yourself. Just by happenstance, I am keeper of the books. You see the opportunity. Oh yes, oh yes. Well, let's split the last bottle and shake an agreement. Indeed, let's us. We first need information. Who knows about the site up there? Where to reach it? How to reach it? Why don't we meet back here in, say, a week to the hour? And see what we can learn meanwhile. We need to find a merchant, too. Someone who can handle it for our warehouses, distribution, and it keep a mouth shut. I'll make some inquiries about merchants. Got a contract or two. Trouble is, well, you know how these things go. Few golds here, a few there. Before you know it, you bribed half the town, or so it seems. Now, as luck would have it, I don't have much. Got swindled by a wretched mage, some town south of here. I lost most of my belongings in a shipwreck. Ah, yes! You need some seed money, as it were. Right to Leben. Let me lift old Steed's furt. Wait. I mean, we left old Steak's purse. He made a lot rent out his sister last night. Reek? Thank you, Rake! How about 100 gold enough? How about 100 gold enough? Oh yes, more than enough for a start. Gentlemen, good. So we have a deal? Yes! Yes, it's agreed. 1 week. Exit Reben, Rake Dragon Steed. Exit the Adventurer. Enter Epilogue. Ah, things are happening now. I doubt it not. Patrons, I request that you recall that this is a work of fiction created by one of the finest writers of the Asylum, Friendships, Archprince of All Somerset. There is no such thing as Fool's Ebony. Furthermore, Ebony is not mined as the priests have described the process. Grasp that, please. If you can still enjoy this play as a rude work of fiction, stay with us for part the three. If you can't, farewell. And don't forget to tap the wenches. And so endeth part the tooth. And so now we're up to date with everything that we have read up until this point. So let's see how the play goes from there. What exactly do we have in store for us? What does part the three have to tell us about the world? Probably nothing. But at least now I have some idea what the play is about. Yeah, part two, it kind of like dumps you in the middle of it, so knowing part one really helped. Wait, where's part two? No, part three, I mean. I have part five, where's part three? I know I have part three. Where's part three? Yes, I know it's somewhere. There we are. Found part three, yes, it's just weirdly organized. Fool's Ebony part the three, yes. Dramatis Personae, Prologue, the Adventurer, Dark Out, Rascal, Coleman, the Priest of Akatosh, Leben, another Priest of Akatosh, Epilogue, Steak, a Priest of Julianos, Rake, another Priest of Julianos, Shub, a Maid, Shub, a different Mage of the same name, Nephron, a somewhat sleazy Merchant, 5 Armorers, Arthur Croon, Husband Millie, a Wesley Testa Millie, Innkeep, and Philosopher Guernsey, Bovine Wench, a Sword Wenches, and Cats of the Tavern, Soldiers, Dwarves, Giants. Part the three, in the Mage's Guild. 1 3 days later. Wait, what does that even mean? 1 3 days? How can you have 1 3 days? 13? Maybe? I don't know. Enter Prologue. We are now at the halfway point of our disjointed epic. If you are just arriving, you have missed little. The Adventurer, a rogue dark elf, has joined with a quadruplet, that's a triumvirate plus one, a priest intent on discovering a burning metal called Fool's Ebony and becoming wealthy. The priests have given our hero some gold for bribing merchants, but the only people who know where the Fool's Ebony is are the mages of the Mages Guild. As the epilogue pointed out at the end of part two, there is no such thing as Fool's Ebony. And real Ebony is not mined. Something a playwright apparently did not research. Well, accept as high fantasy if you will. Or whatever. Hark! Here comes our hero now! Imagine the miasma, if that's the word I want. A magical elixirs, bubbling cauldrons, hovering balls of sparkling, whatnot. And now, the prologue must depart. Enter Adventurer and Shub. Oh, anyone around? Over here, young man, in the corner. Morning. Do I call you Shub? Oh, yes! Shub is my name! Shub it is! How on Tamriel did you know? Can we have some privacy? I have a somewhat delicate matter to discuss. No need for privacy here! We might mages do hide anything! Fool's Ebony? Quick through this door! Turn right, turn left. Just let me throw a privacy spell around us. Loud zap sounds. Enter Shub. God! Now, sir! Oh, by the way, meet my fellow mage, Shub! Now, you mentioned Fool's Ebony! Well, I fancy myself a bit of an expert in ebony. I quite a bit come and go through my hands in my time. I have We notice you have an ebony amulet and an ebony katana of lightning, no less, and an ebony belt.
Hands off the toys, gentlemen. Please.
Forgive us, but we so appreciate such fine items. Collect them, too.
Well, the other day, just by chance, of course, I happened to hear two priests at the temple of Stendar, I think it was. They were a bit high in their cups, I think. A bit loud, and never noticed me skulking. I mean, standing there. They were going on about this fool's ebony. Stuff like the real thing. Only no magicka at all. None. But it burns like wood. Only hot longer. Hotter. No smoke. Nice. Even heat.
Yes, we have heard similar rumors. Seems a bit of that stuff lumps from an old sack or two that some craze Delver dragged up. That kind of thing. Right, Shulma? Oh, yes, yes, that kind of thing, right?
Aside,
I must remember to keep the secret, whatever it is.
Well, these four priests seem to talk as if they knew a location for a lot. I mean, piles of this stuff. Somewhere up in the Rothgarians.
Where? Who? Did they say? How? When? Where? You didn't let them know you were listening, did you?
Of course not. What do you take me for? A priest lover?
Calm yourself, my lord. That's better. Just don't go fiddling with that katana so much. Makes us nervous. Yes, very, very. Here, sit down. There. Want some mulled wine? No? Oh well, just have to finish it myself? So, they seem to know the location.
Aside.
This means we have to act fast. Quickly, speedily, and with great rapidity.
Oh yes. They were talking like they were going to get a load in a few weeks or so.
Oh my, oh dear me, oh! Now then, seems you know a fair amount about this fool's ebony, and you realize the potential. Just think, big warm fires in all our sturdy rooms, selling it to the palace, selling it to those stupid alchemists. The Armorer's Guild would be good for a lot. Keep our familiars nice and warm, and our posteriors. Just think how dangerous seducers love a nice warm fire.
Oh yeah, we know definitely why they like that. We've met dangerous seducers.
Well, at least they're always tying in. Giving smoldering lumps to the peasants to warm their hovels with, in return for some gold, of course. Just think of all that gold! Trouble is, son, we'd like to get that stuff by the cartload, bring it down here, have some trustworthy merchant put a spell on him, have some merchant act as sort of middleman for us.
But then why the delay, gentlemen?
You seem like an honest fellow. We'll tell you. Mind you, you won't have a word of this, and you'll be a fire danger in your bed. But no threats between gentlemen, right?
Very well. I shall be the very soul of discretion.
You see, we know where the stuff is. Cartloads and cartloads of it. But we can't get there and back. We're not the outdoorsy types. Far safer here in town. Much warmer, too. Think of all the supplies you would have to take. All those nasty things out there. Did you know that seducers won't come in the wilderness? We'd have to hire guards to keep those awful priests away. And the strain of dealing with all those coarse types. And the merchants. The armorers. The royals.
I think I can't comprehend. You want some experience, explorer hero type. Someone used to the wilderness to go get it for you. Set up a supply line, and so on.
Exactly! And find us a nice, usable merchant. Someone we can control. With a big, big warehouse, delivery service, that kind of thing.
Well, gentlemen, let me volunteer my services.
I have always admired you, mage gentlemen. So clever, so sharp. No fooling you in anything, is there?
No fooling us!
Enter prologue. This, ladies and gentlemen, is irony. Tell you what I can. Possibly arrange a suitable merchant for you. Take some gold, though. Those thieves would know the value of a gold piece. As luck would have it, my last gold was swindled off by me by a thieving priest in some little town south of here. I lost a lot of good stuff in a shipwreck just before that.
Well, since you have agreed to help us, we can spare some gold from the treasury, can't we, Shub? Oh, yes, there's all... What's there? Always!
Now I need to know roughly where this site is. Got to pick the right breed of horse, recalculate my supplies to the last drop, figure what weapons I might need. Supplies like food, little things like that. Diameter of the cart wheels and square yards, ambush points for the priests, in case they try to get up there.
Tell you what! Here is 500 gold! Go get things started! Yes, we can always make more!
Show beside the shop.
Shut up!
Apparently, mages can make gold, freaking mages. Shub fires a spell at Shub that burns him to a cinder that reconstitutes him. Terrell,
excuse us, where was I? Oh, get a merchant, guards, carts, whatever you think you'll need. Come back if you need more.
But what about those priests? I've got an idea or two there. Let me get friendly with them. Maybe hire a couple of good lamppost girls. Lay in a few cases of holy wine. I'll have them eaten out of my hand in time. If you show me where this fool's ebony is, why, I can misdirect them, send them straight into a troll's den or something.
You're the expert! Here, let me show you a map. And I don't need to mention fire daedras, do I?
So... Seems to be, only 30 days there this time of year. Maybe 40 back with the load. Let me study this a bit more.
Can't take it with you, of course. Don't want this getting out now.
Oh no, that's fine. Let me have a bit more gold. Going to buy some heavy duty carts. See here, this section, cut by all these washes? The vomits there will be something terrible. Oh. And these ruins, full of ghosts, I bet. And this pass, just full of willies, too.
If you say so. My, seems we picked the right man, right, Shub? Oh, right, indeed.
So, why do I make arrangements? Get back to you in, say, a week? Say, sure you don't want to come with me? After all, there's nothing like the wilderness life. Wake up in the sun, shake off the frost, catch an orc for breakfast? Ever have orc guts fried over stinkwood? Oh, that's a treat. Check in each stream for dead giant spiders or live ones. Imp jerky for lunch. Scan the ridges for draglings. Standing guard against ice daedra and a blinding snowstorm. Oh, what a life.
Shubba-shub. No, we better stay here at the guild. Good our duties after all. Someone's got to mind the store. Someone's got to get the word out to selected customers! No, thank you, kind sir. It does sound such a lovely life. I think we best be here. Yes, indeed.
Ah, pity, gentlemen. Well, I'll be about it then. And don't worry if you see me with those priests. Got to mislead and misdirect them, haven't I?
One week, then!
Adzun Shub, adventure in Shub. Enter epilogue.
Shub and Shub, ladies and gentlemen!
In really bad lettering, I don't even know what's going on. Mages, yes. But something more to them than this act suggests. Do you think so, maybe?
Well, if you're not in the theater for part the fourth, you won't know for certain, will you? Don't forget to tip your wenches, and think that while we change the set.
So endeth part the three.
We want to part the fourth!
In this horrible marathon of books. You already remember the tip your wenches while I read this terrible story, right? Because I sure am not. I mean, I have a wenches to tip at the moment. So you guys have to do that for me. Can somebody tip all the wenches here? Be a nice favor. Since I am reading the story after all. Okay, dramatic personae. Prologue, the adventurer, Dark Elf, Rascal Coleman, a priest of Akatosh Lehman, another priest of Akatosh Epilogue Slee, a priest of Julianos Rake, another priest of Julianos Shub, a maid Shub, a different mage of the same name, Nephron, a somewhat sleazy merchant, five armors, Walter Kroon, the husband of Millie, Cortessa Millie, innkeeper of philosopher Guernsey, bovine wench, a sword wenches, a cats of the tavern, soldiers, dwarves, and giants. Part the fourth. Mercantile dealings. The armors involved themselves. After some general discussion and verbal dance around, finally the topic of Fool's Ebony is explored. Somewhere near the market, and the back of a store, called Nephron's General Mercantile, the day after. Enter Prologue, the Adventurer, and Nephron. Well, whilst the actors playing the Adventurer and the Merchant Nephron dramatically move their mouths to pretend a conversation, it's on poor Prologue's shoulders to update the audience on the play's actions and the first three acts. The adventurer, a rogue of a dark elf, has been hired by two different groups, four inebriated priests and two greedy mages, to delay the other group and find the lost cache of the Fool's Ebony in the Rothgarian Mountains. Now, picture this clownishly decorated set as the back room at a prosperous merchant shop. And before the adventurer and Nephron develop lockjaw, Prologue will leave you thus. So you see, friend Nephron, just what an opportunity we have here. We have this new commodity, which you agree that there is huge demand.
Especially with the royals. Once one of them has something new, they all want it, of course.
And do not forget their armors for their forges, and the alchemists for their retorts and whatnot.
You seem to have the mages lined up nicely. Get their location, memorize the access map, and so on. You know, we merchants have had a suspension for quite some time that those little twits had some deep dark secret of interest to us. Now, the priests, the school of Julianos, we already work well with. Hand in glove, you might say. Of course we shall cut them out of the major profits. Maybe let them distribute some of their flocks. And their temple make good. And their temples make good. How can I say storehouses? But Akatosh Chantry is a problem. Always running off and doing things on their own initiative. No cooperation. Just crazy people. We really need to do something about them. To ensure their cooperation. I have a suggestion that might help. You might recall how old Coleman left and apparently dragged off some little blonde lamppost girl. Just suppose that by chance, in his state of befuddlement, he dragged off someone important by mistake.
Oh well, so at a pointless moment, actually you have a point now.
Maybe a lot of trouble for the Chantry if word got out.
Indeed. There's a silly little blonde royal who's all excited by the real life down these parts of town. Disguises herself, or so she thinks, comes on down here and plays at being poor. Stupid little twit. Coleman is still hiding with his blonde, right?
Yes, in that retreat the priests have, down near the waterfront.
Oh yes, I know that place. Often sell them spiritual powders and so on.
Good. You see, just imagine what would happen if Coleman, by mistake, had grabbed this slumming little Cortessa. Akatosh Chantry would have no end of trouble from the place if something happened to her. And then we move in. Offer to help the Chantry during their hard times.
Yes. Leave it to me. I shall contact a few of my business associates, as it were. Make some arrangements. And I'll keep up chatting with the priests. Get them to support our little business venture.
Right! And
I should introduce you to some of the more senior members of our brotherhood. Excuse me, guild. Let me contract you in a few days, when everything is all set. You are here every evening? Yes, not particularly safe outside after dark these days. I see. We shall have to arrange some protection for you. Well, in a few days then. Exit Nephron, inconspicuously. Enter 5 armorers. Armorers and the adventurer fight. The adventurer falls. The armorers tie the adventurer up and then wake him up. Okay, fella, let's not spring and fuck about. We know about this false ebony thing, and about the mages who apparently discovered the location. And we've been watching you dance around with the priests, the mages, the merchants, just about everyone with 2 feet. And now you're really working with Nephron. And how you are double-crossing the priests and mages. You and Nephron must do a good job on the Akatosh Chantry, we must admit. But now, we want that false ebony supply. We need it to increase our production, our quality, our prices. We can work with Nephron and his gang. We need warehouses and distribution anyway. We could torture it out of you. We could let the priests know about your plans. They would throw you to the After Dark Society in a flash. We could let the mages know. They would send you to oblivion for a very, very long time. But we'd rather you joined our guild. We cannot afford to leave Daggerfall for some hairy wilderness trip. Too much demand these days for our services. But we can send a group of our apprentices along to keep you company. Our apprentices usually test all our products. And we'll be itching to test out there. Gentlemen. I was going to give the whole deal to you once I had gotten gold from everyone else. Armor 5 slaps the adventurer with a hot poker. Oh, well, I thought of it.
Sure! And I'm a nymph!
Yes. You're very persuasive. I'd welcome in our escort and guard of such tough gentlemen. Be very handy out there.
Good! Thought you would see it our way. Some of our other members are presently having a little chat with Nephron. We can handle him. And from now on, 2 of our bigger apprentices will always be close at hand. Protection, of course. This town can be quite dangerous at night. You, so continue your arrangements. Work with Nephron. You can always leave word about your departure date with any weapons shop. And about any problems you may have.
Certainly, gentlemen. Yes, you are indeed very persuasive. I shall keep you up to date. And thanks for the protection. Enter Ortho, the very large apprentice. The adventurer is untied. Exhumed 5 armorers. Hello, who are you?
Me, Immortal!
My protection?
Me, Immortal!
You look very familiar to me for some reason. Have you ever been to Morrowind?
Me, Immortal!
Fine then. Aside, my old man used to say the very worst thing to happen to a fellow as an evening spent in the company of an earnest politician. This, I think, is a close second. And soon, adventurer and Ortho. Enter Epilogue. Our play has 6 parts, and we've just finished the 4th. It's interesting, I think the lusty Cortessa has not made an appearance yet. You don't suppose the playwright forgot he put her in the dramatis personae, do you? Well, you only know if you come back for Fool's Ebony Part the 5th. If your neighbor decides not to return, don't tell him what happened. We actors have to make a living too, you know! Don't forget to tip your wenches while we change the scene! Exit Epilogue. So endeth, part the 4th.
Okay. So, we have learned something, specifically me and Ortho. And let's get ready for part the 5th! And this marathon of terrible play parts. But at least we'll make it through it. And can say then we won't have to read Fool's Ebony ever again. Well, I've read this thing.
and what an accomplishment that will be.